Cores versus logical processors. What's really powering your PC? Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. Here's a question I got recently that honestly I'm kind of surprised I haven't touched on before. Hi Leo, what's the difference between a core and a logical processor? For instance, I have two laptops, one with an i7 12th generation, 32 gigs of RAM with 10 cores, 12 logical processors, and one with an i7 11th generation, 32 gigs of RAM with 4 cores and 8 logical processors. So what's the difference between a core and a logical processor? Okay, let's do this. The CPU in your computer is amazingly, unfathomably complex. How complex? That 11th generation i7 CPU has over 19 billion, with a B, transistors. Now, I realize that's mostly meaningless unless you know what a transistor really is or does, but it's kinda sorta like having 19 billion tiny on-off switches in a space less than 1/2 of a square inch. Some of those switches set up a feature that defines the difference between a core and a logical processor. Now, before we dive in, I gotta throw this out there. This is not a primer on CPU architecture. This is an attempt to describe some of the more common underlying concepts in terms that more people can understand. By definition, it's going to be wrong around the edges and in the picky details. That's not what this article or video is about. All right, a core. A core is normally a processing engine that takes a sequence of instructions and executes them one step at a time. For example, let's have a look at some sequences of steps that we might take. Step one might be to just take the number 23. Then step two, fetch the number from RAM in a specific location. Step three would be to add these two numbers. Step four might be to store the result in a specific RAM location. Then step five might be to add 23 to the result. And step six might be to store the result in RAM location something. Now, yes, that's really boring, but it's this level of granularity that the CPU is operating at. Simple math, logical operations, RAM access, and those kinds of things. That's what makes your computer do all of the fantastical things it does, even though it's just doing one thing at a time. We refer to that as being single-threaded. There's one thread of operation. Now, needless to say, it's doing this really, really fast. While the clock speed isn't one for one because some things take longer than others, a reasonable visualization is that a 3 gigahertz processor, for example, is capable of performing 3 billion of these simple operations, like addition, every second. Of course, you know where that's going. That's not fast enough. Hyperthreading. Hyperthreading is also known as simultaneous multithreading. It's a technique where a single core can sometimes do two things at once. A metaphor I ran into recently that I really liked is that a CPU might be a single person, but you've got two hands. Now, sometimes you need both hands to do one thing, but sometimes you can do two different things at the same time. For example, step one, thread one takes the number 23. It just loads it up. Thread two fetches a number from RAM. For step two, thread one fetches a number from RAM, while thread two increments what it had previously fetched by one. For step three, thread one is going to add the two numbers that it has, while thread two is storing whatever it came up with back into RAM. Step four, thread one is going to store its result in RAM, while thread two now has to wait. For step five, thread one is adding 23 to its result, whereas thread two is now finally able to store something in RAM. And I'll explain the final part of that comment in a minute. Step 6, thread 1 now gets to store its result in RAM, where thread 2 again has to wait. And for step 7 now, we added something just because it needed something to be there, subtracts 14 from whatever it has as its result, but thread 2 is now able to store its result in RAM. All right, what was all that about? Look carefully and you can see that thread 1 and thread 2 are both doing things at the same time. They're on a single CPU, but they're doing things at the same time. Here's the thing. In this manufactured example, the store and fetch things from RAM part of the CPU and the perform simple arithmetic part of the CPU are two separate things. Now, in single threading, the previous example, we can use only one at a time. In hyper-threading, we can use both of these two things at the same time. In other words, we could be storing and fetching something from RAM at the same time as we're performing simple arithmetic. By doing that, we can simulate two completely separate things at the same time. The two threads of execution, for example, do two completely separate, and in this case, unrelated things at the same time, simply by coordinating how these two pieces of the CPU are used at the same time. It's not perfect. Like I said, at thread 2 has had to wait a couple of times. At step 4 and again at step 6, it had to wait because it wanted to do something to RAM at the same time that thread 1 was also wanting to do something from RAM. That means that they were both trying to use that same part of the CPU at the same time. They can't. One or the other is going to have to wait. In this case, I arbitrarily picked thread 2. CPU scheduling is way more complex than we'll ever get into. But the point is that, yeah, thread 2, when it's trying to do something that requires a resource that thread 1 is using, it's going to have to wait. Thread 1, on the other hand, once it moved on to some kind of an arithmetic operation, then finally thread 2 could move on and actually access the RAM. It's a single CPU, but it's doing two things at once. Sort of. The operating system makes use of this by viewing it as two separate logical processors, even though there's really only one. Okay, with hyper-threading kind of sort of out of the way, multi-core gets kind of easy. Your computer can have multiple cores. In fact, these days, almost all computers do. The desktop computer I'm using right now as I record this has 16 cores. That means using the original definition of a simple, single-threaded core, it can literally do 16 things at once. But these cores are also all hyper-thread capable. That means that while my desktop has 16 cores, it looks like it has 32 logical processors. So, here's an interesting catch. You pointed out that your 12th generation i7 processor has 10 cores and 12 logical processors. Well, turns out not all cores are made to be hyper-threading capable. In your case, it looks like only 2 of the 10 on this processor are. And that's why you end up with 12 logical processors overall. Now, so far, I've referred to cores and logical processors, all living on a single chip in your computer. The 16-core processor that I have on my machine, it's a single chip. It's a single piece of silicon somewhere inside my computer. A computer can contain multiple physical CPU chips. These days, that's actually pretty uncommon for home and small businesses, but not that uncommon at the industrial data center scale. While the operating system does actually see all the chips and all the cores, it primarily operates on what it just sees as a nice large collection of available logical processors. So all of this is really mostly for your curiosity, but it may come in useful in the next time you're shopping for a new computer and you're trying to compare the capabilities of one against the other. Hope that helps a little bit. For updates, for comments, for links related to this topic and more, visit askleo.com/181771. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is AskLeo.com. Thanks for watching.